invite the congregation to please stand as you're able. We gather to worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to turn in your bulletin this morning to our hymn of praise.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit to be with you all.
Also
may be seated. Good morning. Welcome to worship. Special welcome to those who are watching us online. Glad that you're joining us this morning, and encourage you on that YouTube link in the description. Please fill out that connection card so that we can keep in touch with you. Here in the sanctuary, if you're a guest with us, we're glad that you're worshiping here. There's a green visitor card in your pew. If you would fill that out and place that in the offering plate when it comes by. And just a couple other announcements. We do have our new member class begins today at noon. So if you've been visiting for a while and you like it, and you're like, I think this is my church, we'd love for you to go through our new member process. We'll be upstairs in the fireside room today at 12. And today is just a day to get to know one another and introduce the staff and the church. So I encourage you to participate in that. The Rebecca Circle will meet on Tuesday, August 10th at 10:30 in Luther Hall for fellowship and an early lunch. Daniel Wicks, our own Daniel Wicks, has an organ recital today at 3 p.m. on YouTube. And so I encourage you to tune in for that. The picture directory pictures are being taken in the gathering place. If you haven't already had your picture taken, I encourage you to sign up and do that. During the month of August, we'll be collecting food for Care and Share. So I encourage you all through. We have 5 Sundays this month. I encourage you every Sunday to bring something, canned food, non-perishable items, and we'll collect those and deliver those to people in need. The office will be closed Thursday and Friday this week as the staff are going for some staff development. We're attending the Willow Creek Leadership Conference together. And so pray for us that we would be encouraged and enthused for the coming ministry year. And save the date. August 22nd is our grand opening for the Peel House from 1 to 4. And so we'll have all sorts of a mini parade and celebrations. There's going to be a lot of fun stuff, and you'll get to see the house in all of its glory. So August 22nd, save the date for that. I believe that's all of the announcements. Will you stand as we prepare our hearts for worship by confessing our sin? Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. I invite you to take a moment to allow the Holy Spirit to examine your heart as you confess your sin to God. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our opening hymn, Praise to the Lord the Almighty, is number 858 in your red hymnal. Let's sing together. The children to come forward at this time for a children's message. We might have a kid or two. Yeah. Come on down.
See you on this nice bright hello this nice bright rainy day, right? Yeah, well, you know, we're going to talk a little bit about suffering today. Did Jesus suffer for us? He did. What did he do? He died on the cross. That's right. And were there many people really trying to get him down off of that cross? No, there were guards there. I mean, people couldn't even get close to him, but They very much cared for him, and they were sad, they were crying, so their hearts were there. They wanted to help him very, very much, but they couldn't. We weren't there when he died on the cross, right? That's a long time ago. But could we have gotten him down? Probably not. We wished we could have. Would we have been sad? Absolutely, absolutely. So, Jesus helped us. He helps us now. How could he help us now? Just like he did years and years ago when he was alive. What did he do back then, even? Do you remember when he raised people from the dead? And people were sick, and they'd come up to him, And he would heal them. Absolutely, he would heal them. He would take care of them for sure. But he's not here today. Can he still help us? He can. How do we get in contact with him? We can't text or... What do? We pray. We absolutely do. Can we just pray at night in our beds? No. Can we pray when we're driving down the road with our parents? What about when we're biking and we're just praying? Sure. Anytime. We can pray to God anytime. Now, here's the thing. God said for us to go out and help people as well. What does that look like for us? What could you do to help someone? What if they were sad? Give them a hug. Absolutely. I mean, you know, COVID and everything, maybe a fist bump, but yeah, a hug for sure, definitely. What if someone was on their bike and kaboom? Help them up. What if they had owies on their knees? Help them with Band-Aids and maybe take them to our parents or their parents, right? Because we got to be cautious about getting it clean and everything. For sure, we'd want to help them. There's lots of things we can do to help people. It might even be someone who's not our age, someone who's much older. What could we do to help someone who's much older that we think, they're kind of sad, besides a hug? Oh, my goodness, make a card, yes. Put it on their doorstep, mail it, you know, whatever. But we can help people. And that's what Jesus tells us to do. He says, I died on the cross, so I can't be here on earth anymore, but all of us are. Everybody is still on earth, and we can help all the time. It's not just, you know, once in a while. We can always help. We can pray for people. Boom. We can make them cards, give them hugs, heal, you know, help them heal when they've been fallen or hit themselves. We can do all of those things because that's what Jesus told us to do. And just by being nice to someone is telling them that we care and we want to help them out. So that's what we have to remember. Go out and be there for each one of us. Be there for everybody, even our moms, dads, brothers, sisters. I know that can be hard, but we need to be there for them too. Okay? Awesome. Let's go out and let's do a fun activity to help us remember what to do.
Our first reading this morning is taken from 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter. You can find that on page 936 in the Pew Bible. I'll give you a minute to turn there. Again, that's page 936, 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter. But we have this treasure in clay jars so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. But just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed and so I spoke, we also believe and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel according to Luke, the 23rd chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As they led Jesus away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with Jesus. They came to the place that is called the Skull. They crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his left and one on his right. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Continue this sermon series on imitating Jesus, we must look to the central event of Jesus' life. If we who claim Jesus as Lord and Savior want our lives to look like his life, then we must become students of the cross. The cross is central to our understanding of who God is and how God wants us to live this life. Jesus said as much in Luke 9, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me." But what does that mean? What does it mean to take up your cross? Why would Jesus choose a gruesome method of state execution as his symbol for discipleship? When Jesus first uttered these words, "Take up your cross," the only crosses people knew about had dead and dying people on them. They were symbols of Roman power, not of God's power. They were something to be feared, not something to pursue. But now we adorn our sanctuaries with crosses. We wear them around our necks. We sing beautiful songs about the cross. "Lift high the cross, the old rugged cross. Jesus, keep me near the cross." What are we talking about? What was Jesus talking about? I think the simplest way to think about it is to say that Jesus calls Christians to move toward the pain and suffering of this world. There are dead and dying people on crosses, and we are called to move toward suffering. If we want to imitate Jesus, if we want to copy his life, if we want our lives to look like his life, then we need to move toward suffering, rather than be repelled by it. I was talking with our youth director, Shelley, the other day about how so many of our young people have this story told to them about the church and all the sins of the church throughout history. They hear this story of the church and the Crusades and the Inquisition and defending slavery. And while that is true and we repent of it, that is the story of the church when it's not following Jesus, when it's not being Christian. Because when the church is at its best, following Jesus into the pain and suffering of this world, then there is another story to tell our children. One example of this story is during the 4th century, there was a plague that lasted for 13 years. How many of you are tired of the coronavirus plague? It's been a year and a half. 13 years under this plague, killing people. And the way Christians responded to that ancient pandemic was to invent hospitals. While their pagan counterparts were fleeing to the cities to escape the illness, Christians went to work on the front lines, caring for the sick, sitting with the dying, offering comfort and healing with the best science of the day. Can you imagine a world without hospitals? It is Christians following the way of the cross that have founded hospitals in every city. Christians are the ones who created the Red Cross. It's why our hospitals are so often named after saints. Our own church, the Lutheran Church, runs the Augustus Victoria Hospital in Jerusalem, which is where both Israelis and Palestinians come to be healed after they've gotten injured in conflict with one another. Christians enter into the pain of others, and we stand with them even at the point of death. Even today, in the city of Colorado Springs, the city calls us here at First Lutheran when someone dies who doesn't have family members to bury them. The state calls upon the church to bury the dead because they know that part of what it means to be a Christian is to stand with those who have no one to stand with them. Both Pastor Carey and myself have been called upon to stand over the graves of abandoned infants and commend them to the Lord. Some of you volunteer with hospice to be with people in the last days of their lives, making sure no one dies alone. This is the example Jesus gave us when he went to the cross. We are to enter into the pain of others, to go to the hardest parts of the human experience. And that's what Jesus did. He emptied himself of all the privilege and power of heaven and entered into our world. And he didn't just enter into our world, but he entered into the hardest, darkest parts of our world. He was born poor to poor parents. He was a refugee for a time in Egypt as his parents tried to protect his life. He was raised in a small village and entered ministry as a homeless man with no place to lay his head. He was targeted by those in power, arrested and tried without representation on trumped-up charges. He was beaten several times, a crown of thorns cut into his head. He was blindfolded and hit so that he couldn't even brace himself against the blows. And after all of this, he was forced to carry a 200-pound beam of wood that would become the form of his execution on a cross. And he couldn't do it. He was so exhausted by the torture that he dropped it, and a bystander was forced to carry it for him. And then, while on the cross and dying, Jesus shows us what it means to be his disciples. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. He forgave those who nailed him to the cross. And he entered into conversation with the criminals to his left and right. Do you see what Jesus has done here? He offers salvation to criminals while he himself is dying. This is our example. This is what it means to follow Jesus. It's not just about offering help to those who are beneath us, who are worse off than us. It's about being with people fully, right next to them, in the fullness of what they're going through, and serving them even when we are in need ourselves. It's Bonhoeffer choosing to go back to Nazi Germany instead of staying in the comfort of his cushy seminary job here in the United States. It's Martin Luther King Jr. marching side by side into a phalanx of police instead of just preaching safely from his pulpit. It's Mother Teresa living in the streets of Calcutta along the lepers and the poor. The word compassion literally means to suffer with. The passion of the Christ teaches us to suffer alongside our fellow humans and proclaim our trust in God. Maybe another way to get at this is to look at a story that happened this week with Simone Biles. She got hurt. Her mind wasn't healthy. It put her at risk of personal injury and hurting her team's chances. So she withdrew from Olympic competition so she could heal. And there have been many responses. Some have focused on the loss of the gold medal for her team and herself, because that's what our world cares about. It cares about winning, about glory, about standing on top of that podium. The world encourages suffering and sacrifice only if it comes with a gold medal at the end. How many have called her out for being weak? Just another example of how this generation has gone soft. Have you heard that? But Simone is like Jesus. In her weakest moment, she has shown a light on the mental health challenges of other athletes and young people in the world. She has given people permission to show their weakness, to be honest about it, rather than gloss over it for a brief moment of glory. Our world likes winners. Jesus likes losers. Literally, Jesus says, "Those who lose their life for my sake will gain it for eternity." And Paul wrote to the Corinthians, "God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God." We Christians who imitate Jesus are to be foolish, weak, low, and despised, just like Jesus was on the cross, so that we can share the gospel with those whom the world calls low and weak and despised. We are to be with the sick, with the disabled, with the imprisoned, with the institutionalized, with those whose lives have fallen apart. We are to be with the depressed and the poor and the uneducated and the weak-minded. We are to be with the guilty and the abused and the hurting. We are to be with them so they can know that God sees the truth of their life and does not turn away. We are to be with them so they can hear the good news that God is with you no matter where you are, no matter how bad the pain is, no matter how deep the shame, no matter how much you've messed up or how badly you're hurting. God is there, and he's with you. Just like Jesus was with the man on the cross being executed for his crimes against society, the lowest of the low. Jesus didn't condemn the man, didn't judge him, but was right there with him, fully understanding what he was going through and offering him eternal life on the spot. This is our task in the world that pretends things really aren't that bad, look on the bright side, and glosses over real pain and suffering and death. Our task is to stand in the darkness and tell the truth about the reality of suffering and the reality of God's presence in it and his love. We proclaim that God sees the world as it really is and brings salvation to the darkest parts of humanity. What does that look like in your life? What does it look like for you when you see pain and suffering and darkness, to move towards it rather than away from it? When the rest of the world is repelled by human suffering, what does it look like for you to take a step towards it? Sometimes it's a simple thing, like visiting a loved one who has dementia and has nothing to offer you, can't give anything back, but you go and visit anyway. Sometimes it's a phone call to someone who's going through a hard time. And I know so many people who, when they went through a divorce, they were surprised at how few of their friends were there with them. And those who were there wouldn't say anything about the divorce they were experiencing. When we hit rock bottom, that's when we find out who our true friends are. And Christians ought to be rock bottom friends because we follow Jesus who found us at the bottom. You know, sometimes it's as simple as refusing to abandon somebody when they have messed up their life, when they have been found guilty, when they've done something reprehensible and the rest of the world hates them. We Christians stand with them and tell them of a God who forgives sin. Jesus stood with the losers of the world, while the rest of the world cheers those at the top of the podium. Jesus is in the shadows with those who are defeated and crying. And that's where we should be too, as disciples of this Jesus. So people of God, go find the losers, the weak, the sinners. Go and be with them and tell them of the one who told a thief on the cross that today he would be with Jesus in paradise. Copy that. Amen. The hymn of the day is in your bulletin. Let's stand and sing together.
For the church, the world, and all those in need. Holy God, you gave your Son for us. Let us live into new life as we take up our cross, living into pain and suffering, growing in our call to live as Jesus lived. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, creator of the universe, you have given us the responsibility to care for your creation. Guide us to care for the earth and for each other, using all you have given us. Lord, in your mercy. Dear God, you are the leader we seek. Guide the leaders of this world to make good decisions, to lead with integrity and in truth. Let us lift them up in care and support. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, you are our healer. We pray for those who struggle with their health, for those who suffer silently, for those who don't believe they are enough. Let us care for the sick. Let us walk with them in support and in prayer rather than judgment and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. God of all people, you gave Jesus, who walks with us in darkness and in light. Salvation and eternal life are yours. Guide us to live like Jesus and to love as God first loved us. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us share that peace with one another. With you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As a reminder, this is Christ's table. All are welcome to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion. We'll come forward and receive communion at the rail this morning. If you need a gluten-free wafer, you can receive those from the usher on your way forward to the altar here. Also, if you are communing on the pulpit side this morning, you'll need to take your empty cup with you and dispose of it in the basket that's just behind the first post over here. So don't wait up here for somebody to come and get it from you. You have to take it with you and put it in the basket over there, just this side. You guys are good. So, right. Again, this is Christ's table. All are welcome. Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
the congregation to please stand as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning can be found in your bulletin, O Christ the Same.
Peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.